Okay, Jane, I'm fearing you're going to fall off.
I know! That's what we're trying to do. I think if you do this, you can get comfortable there.
Because I'm so pleased to see everybody.
We win.
Join us. do that and you would like to work during the week, if you look right over there, Brady's already signing up all over the place. Join him. Find a spot where you can sign up for the patch. Just write your name on a little yellow sheet and stick it up there. There are lots of spots open. And I can just tell you from personal experience, this is the best way to have fellowship and fun and visit with people. Jamie and Gary last year were like relatives by the end of the patch. So please try to sign up at some point for that. Our missions is also collecting items for a first breakfast meal at First United Methodist Church. And there's a black tub over here. If you brought deodorant, soap, toothpaste, and things like that, you can drop it in that tub. Okay, and this month's communion meal offering is going to go to Pinky Promise. Please write on your communion, on your check memo line, and it goes to Pinky Promise if that's where it's going to go. Next week, we will be in a patch with all of the pumpkins. So wear orange, is all I can say. Thank you again for joining us for worship this morning.
Please stand. There you go.
And join me in singing Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. You can find the words on your song sheet. Of the changing seasons and of the beauty that comes with it.
We give thanks that we are here together, singing, praying, and worshiping. We give thanks for this beautiful space on our church property that gives us this opportunity to gather safely. And we give thanks for your presence here with us today. We are indeed a blessed and privileged people, for you have created us, sustained us, saved us, and called us your own children. We ask that you would lead us. Give us patient and humble hearts. Give us wisdom and discernment. Help us see and recognize your will, not only for our lives, but for our church, that we might live into that which we have been created and called to be. We ask all of this in the name of your Son Jesus, and we pray now the words that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Moment, come and find a seat and wear your mask, please. Good to see you. You know, I've just been doing so many messages online. Sometimes I'm thinking, is anybody watching? And yeah, that's okay, because some of us might say, oh, I love what you told us on Children's Moment. So he went to meet Rebecca's family. God has chosen Rebecca as the wife of Abraham's son Isaac. The servant said to Rebecca's family, will you let me take her home today, Isaac? Please answer Rebecca. family. Isaac was waiting for them. Isaac and Rebecca were married. So in this story, we learn that servant prayed and God answered prayers. So why was this? You know, I'm always trying to think of some way to remind us to pray. Have a little Lego block. You either keep it in your bag or take it out. And so when you have this little Lego block, put that touch one and one. Oh, let me get you one. There you go. Sorry about that. Anybody else want to have a block? So on that first little block, we can pray for ourselves. And we can ask God, we can ask God to bless us. And bless us to be a blessing to others. And then I was looking, how many dots are on my bus right here? Six. So I can pray for six people in my family. And ask God to bless them. And then I can take my block and I can think, look at all my friends at Trinity. I need more than six dots. I can pray for my friends at Trinity. Or I can pray for my friends at school. And then I can say, God, please bless my friends. And thank God for my friends. Okay, let's go to early high. If we put these all together, we can make a big church. I want you to be praying for our church. Pray that everybody will stay healthy, and then we'll all come together each Sunday. And then be praying for those pumpkin unloads, and when people come, they'll know that they're going to add a friendly, friendly church. We like pumpkins, I love them too. They're just my best friend. I do. I love those pumpkins, I just love them. We'll just be green and orange pretty soon. So I want you to take your little Lego blocks home, put it by your bed, and then you need to pray. And you can think of different things you can pray. And on the back, you can just be like, pray unceasingly. I find a Bible verse that you really love and write on the back. And if you do that, and Mom says, hey, I love that Bible verse. I'm going to share that with Miss Denise. Have her take a picture of you and your Lego block, okay? And then you can put it on the website or on email, okay? All right. Let's start over here. Say it with me, please. Dear God, thank you for our church.
Thank you for our church.
And this beautiful place to worship.
And this beautiful place to worship.
We love you, Lord.
We love you, Lord.
And we thank you for all of our blessings.
Lord, thank you for all of our blessings.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Bye-bye, friends.
Denise, may I borrow your Bible, please? It leaves out all the Hebrew words. That would be nice. Good morning, church. And please prepare your hearts to hear the Word of God is spoken through Genesis 24, 1 through 19. Now, Abraham was very old, and the Lord had blessed him in every way. He said to the senior servant in his household, the one in charge of all that he had, put your hand under my thigh. I want you to swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of earth, that you will not get a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites, among whom I am living. But we'll go to my country and my own relatives and get a wife for my son Isaac. The servant asked him, what if the woman is unwilling to come back with me to this land? Shall I then take your son back to the country you came from? Make sure you do not take my son back there, Abraham said. The Lord, the God of heaven, who brought me out of my father's household and my native land, and who spoke to me and promised me on earth, saying, to your offspring I will give this land. He will send his angel before you so that you can get a wife for my son from there. If the woman is unwilling to come back here with you, then you will be released from this oath of mine. Only do not take my son back there. So the servant put his hand under the thigh of his master, Abraham, and swore an earth oath to him concerning this matter. Then the servant left, taking with him 10 of his master's camels, loaded with all kinds of good things from his master. He set out for Aram Naharaim and made his way to the town of Nahor. He had the camels kneel down near the well outside the town. It was toward evening, the time when the women go out to draw water. Then he prayed, Lord God of my master Abraham, make me successful today and show kindness to my master Abraham. See, I am standing beside the spring, and the daughters of the townspeople are coming out to draw water. May it be that when I say to a young woman, please let down your jar that I may have a drink, and she says, drink, and I'll water your camels too. Let her be the one you have chosen for your servant Isaac. By this I will know that you have shown kindness to my master. Before he had finished praying, Rebecca came out with her jar on her shoulder. She was the daughter of Bethuel, son of Milcah, who was the wife of Abraham's brother, Nahor. The woman was very beautiful, a virgin. No man had ever slept with her. She went down to the spring, filled her jar, and came up again. The servant hurried to meet her and said, please give me a little water from your jar. Drink, my lord, she said, and quickly lowered the jar to her hands and gave him a drink. After she had given him a drink, she said, I'll draw water for your camels too, until they have had enough to drink. This is the word of God for the people of God.
There would be a spring that would spring up that would be named for some great thing that God had done for his people. And they would call the well by that name, and they would build stones around it to collect that water. It was the water from a spring or from a river was called living water, and it was different from captured water, like that was in a cistern. The living water, if you remember in Jesus' story in the New Testament, when he meets the woman at the well, he says, "If those who come to me, I will give them living water." And living water was different in that when the Jewish people would do their rituals, their washing rites, their purification rites, there were some things that... captured water wasn't good enough. It had to be living water. And one of those things was touching something that was dead. So that water from the well, that living water, kind of has echoes throughout our New Testament understanding of what God has done for us through baptism. That living water has brought us back to life and death. And so it's really important to hear these stories. Also, I think, in our culture, we have kind of become biblically illiterate in that we know some scriptures, but we don't know all of the stories and the order in which they occurred, so we don't really have always a context in which to put the things that we memorize. So it's really important for us as Christians to hear these stories and to remember that God has been active in the life of his people for a long time. So last week, if you listened to my sermon online, you already know this, but you may not have done that. I talked about Abraham and Sarah. And Abraham and Sarah, in their old age, God promised them, I mean really old. I mean, we would all probably, be in shock, to say the least, if we were in our 80s and God said, oh, you are going to have a child. But that's what happened. God promised Abraham and Sarah not only that they would have a child together, but that they would have descendants that would number the stars. And, you know, they became impatient. And so the scripture last week was really about how when we become impatient with God and take things into our own hands, it kind of mess up the plan, that God still redeems it. And so Abraham and Sarah did end up having a child together, and his name was Isaac. And you may remember the story when God tells Abraham to take Isaac up to the mountain and sacrifice him on the altar. And Abraham does that, knowing that God has made this promise, that God in the end spares Isaac. And so this is the story of Isaac finding his wife, Rebecca. And we see, you know, Abraham is old. Sarah has just died. And so he's starting to worry now. Isaac is getting to that age of being married. And once again, he wants to ensure that, you know, his descendants number the stars and that they just have the blood from his family. And I want to remind you that there were no Israelites at this time. The Israelites were named after Jacob, who God changes his name to Israel. And Jacob is Abraham's grandson. But Abraham is still a chosen person, chosen by God to bring forth these people out of which the Son of God will come. And so we see Abraham kind of getting a little nervous, and he sends his servant to go back to his people to find a wife for Isaac. And he meets Rebecca at the well. And now, you know, like most of us, when we don't, you know, we have faith, but sometimes, you know, we have that kind of just-in-case mentality. Just in case, they brought a whole bunch of valuable goods to bribe whoever it might be to come back, just in case, you know, God wasn't going to be strong enough to do that. We kind of get ahead of ourselves. But we find this beautiful story of this woman who meets the servant at the well and not only gives him a drink of water, but says, let me draw more water for so that your animals might drink as well. And in the end, she goes back with the servant and marries Isaac. And they have two children, Esau and Jacob. And we'll talk next week about Jacob. But they live together and have these two children. And as the scripture tells us, they love each other. And so there are a couple things. Now, this is very different from our culture. We may know people or work with people who have had a marriage that's been prearranged by their parents, but it really isn't a part of our American culture. We want to meet someone that we enjoy being with. We want to choose. But even though this story really is so distant from our way of life, there are lots of things that we can learn from this story. And so the first one I want to say, Denise talked about, and that was that God answers prayer. Still today, God is as alive and active in our lives as he was in the life of Abraham. But there are other things. So these are the four main things that I have drawn from the story to share with you that I think all of us at one time or another need to remind ourselves. The first is there are things in our lives that seem like major problems that God will take care of if we let go of them. I have a 5-year-old granddaughter named Claire, and she will get very upset about a number of things, the color of her socks, I mean, just major things. And my daughter will very calmly say to her, Claire, your feelings are really big right now, they. And she'll go, and she'll say, how big are your feelings? And she'll say, they're this big. And she says, What happens when our feelings get that big? And she says, we can't see anything else. And she said, that's right. And what do we have to do to make our feelings smaller? And she goes, breathe. And then she'll breathe and she'll get it all under control. And sometimes I wish that, you know, that voice would play my mind, because it's true. We get worked up about things and we can't see in the whole context of life how small they are, because they seem like major things to us. And you know, finding a spouse for a lot of people, a major thing. Finding the right college, finding the right job, having children, all of those things can be things that really consume us, that we put lots of energy into. And forget sometimes that if we let go, that God will work it out. So my first appointment as a pastor was here in Denton at Cooper Creek United Methodist Church on the, out in the kind of rural east side off of 380 on Mingo. Some of you may know where it is. It's kind of a little house on the prairie church. You park under the oak trees. And at the time, there were about maybe 30 people would come for worship. And our lay leader was also our organist. He was a whole bunch of things, but he also was our organist, keyboard player. And his daughter would lead the music. And she was probably in her maybe early 20s when I got there. And I was there for 6 years. And toward the end of that time, I'd probably been there about 4.5 years or so, and we were talking one day, and she was talking about, you know, that she wanted to get married and have kids. Well, she was a teacher in dental school. She still is in an elementary school. And I said, so where do you think you'll meet your husband? Because literally, she taught in an elementary school full of women and children, and went to church, and that was pretty much it. And she said, God will bring the right person to me. And I said, but if you don't go out anywhere, I was new and young in ministry, if you don't go out anywhere, how are you ever going to meet the person God has chosen for you? And she said, if he's the right person, God will just bring him to church, and he'll walk up to the front, and he'll introduce himself. And I thought, yeah, okay, we'll see how well that goes. Well, it was probably about 3 months later. One of my friends who was going to church there brought in her banker, who, because every time she'd go through the drive-thru and he'd talk to her, she'd think, he would be perfect for Elizabeth. So one day, she brings him to church, sits with him there to church. After church, she brings him up to the front, and she said, Elizabeth, this is Joel. Joel, this is Elizabeth. You guys are adults. Figure it out. And she left. She left him there, and I think they've been married now about 13 years, and have 2 children, and are extremely happy. And you know, she wasn't worried about it. It was something that she wanted, to get married and have children, but it didn't consume her, so that all of her energy was going into finding that person. She just trusted God. And you know, I think there are a lot of things that if we would just let go of control and let God do what God does, that in the end, we would find what we need, and we would be happy, and in the meantime, we could be busy doing the work that God has given us. So that's one thing, that sometimes things seem like major problems, but God already has them under control, so just don't worry about it. Second thing, and so, you know, that thought or that thing that we can draw from really is from the perspective of Abraham. Because he was the one. Isaac wasn't even worried. Isaac was not saying, I need to find a wife, and I don't want to marry a Canaanite woman. Yeah, he was not thinking any of those things. In fact, you never know. He might have had his eye on a few Canaanite women while he was going to school or whatever he was doing in the area. It was Abraham that was worried. He wanted it to happen before he died. He wanted to see it. He wanted to make sure. You know, he trusted that God would make sure that something good happened, but just in case. Just in case, God, I'm going to send my servant out with a whole bunch of goodies and give him some instructions. So from Abraham's perspective, that was probably a lesson maybe that Abraham learned. From the perspective of Isaac, sometimes God is working on things even before you think there is a problem. And like I said, Isaac was not the one who was out looking for a wife. That was Abraham. You know, I read on Facebook not too long ago, somebody had said, decades before Zacchaeus climbed that tree to get a better look at Jesus, somebody had planted the seed. And I think we forget that God exists outside of time. He not only knows our needs before we're aware of them, but has already begun to provide for them. And so I think that's a really important thing. And whatever it is we're struggling with, that God is aware, and there already is something in the works. So just this morning I had someone come up to me and mention something that had been prayed for, that now had been answered. I want to say hallelujah, because I was worrying about that same thing, not specifically, but praise God. God was already doing something before I was even aware that there was an answer to prayer that I needed. So from Rebecca's standpoint, so here's Rebecca, you know, just minding her own business, going out to get some water like she did every day, and all of a sudden, she's part of the new thing. And so I guess one of the things that I would say about Rebecca is just be nice. Sometimes we are the answer to God's prayer. And, you know, all of us, we get caught up in our own things that are going on. When we're at the grocery store and our head is, you know, doing a million things, and we maybe walk past someone who needs help, that God puts us in places where we can do good. And often, as we become the answer to someone else's prayer, we also receive a blessing. And then the last person, and I think this is the one, you know, this is the lesson that God keeps putting in my mind. I think it's because I totally haven't learned it yet. But this is from the perspective of the servant. So, you know, we have Abraham sending out the servant to go and to do this. And this is what I want you to say, and this is what I want you to do, and don't do it this way, make sure it happens this way, and the servant just goes and does it. And so this is a lesson that God keeps telling me. Sometimes it just isn't about us. Sometimes God has us do things, and it has nothing to do with an answer to prayer for us. It has nothing to do with any kind of blessing that's going to come to us. Sometimes God calls us to do things because there's someone else who is in need, and that he wants us to intervene and become a part of that answer. So we have this story from thousands of years ago about this old man whose wife has died, and he sends his servant back to his own country to bring back a wife for his son. And the result is that he has children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and great-great-grandchildren, and out of the midst of that comes the one who would save us. It's an important story. And if you think about the role that that servant played, it may seem minor, but in the greater story, we don't even, I think, know his name. But he went and he did it, he was called to do, and he was part of the work of God in the world. And so for many of us, That can be the greatest thing that we can hope for, is that God calls us to do something and we do it and we never know what a great extent the result of that work is, that we trust God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks to you. We give thanks to you for these Old Testament stories that happened so long ago to people that we do not know. But we thank you that there are things that we can glean from these stories, reminders of your faithfulness and your love, reminders that you are God and we are not, and that we are called to serve you. We ask that you would continue to remind us of these things, that you would give us peace, and that you would fill us with your joy in knowing that we have been a part of the story that you have already written. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand and join me in singing The Gift of Love.
Gospel out into the world. Amen.